Turn in your Bibles, you have one in the pew in front of you if you don't have one, to 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we're going to go through the first four verses as we go through the sermon this morning. Today we honor those who fought for the freedom of our nation, especially those who died fighting to keep it free. There are those who died with active service in war, and those who from acts of humanitarian service, such as the six that perished in Nepal just a week ago as they were helping people get water and food in the villages after the earthquake. Each soldier who passed away was committed to the task and to this nation, to join and defend our country from the enemy, help people in need. We face a different enemy today, the ISIS movement in the Middle East, and counterparts in Africa and the Middle East as well. They're a brutal and cruel force of people, and the treatment of those they captured. Thousands of Christians have lost their life and been martyred. Open Door Ministry said this in a notice I read this past week from the notice from the Islamic State recently read. Whoever doesn't know the Quran, whoever doesn't pray five times a day, whoever believes and confesses Christ will be killed. There are tens of thousands of people still in Iraq, especially in the city of Ramadi that was just taken over, that cannot leave and will lose their lives because of their faith in Christ Jesus. Christians, men, women, and children around the world are the new heroes in the war against the body of Christ. You and I are in this battle too. The Bible tells us that we are, as we receive Christ as our Savior, as Lord, we are all soldiers in Christ's army. We are facing the enemy, the devil, who's out to destroy us. I strongly believe the battle between true believers and Satan is going to get worse as the days go on. Many more Christians are going to die for their faith around the world. It may be that even in America, we will face suffering and persecution and rage from the enemy, and we may even be called upon to die for our faith in Christ here in North America. God is in the business of amassing an army, soldiers who are willing to count the cost and pay the price to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Will you be one of them? If you know Christ, you are in the army of Christ. And we need to realize that we're in a battle, a big battle against Satan today. Are we willing to face the enemy in the battle for righteousness? Battle for the enemy isn't new. As we go into this passage in Timothy, we realize that Paul had faced that battle every day as he went on his missionary journeys. Everywhere he went, he paid the price for being a Christian, persecuted, beaten, stoned, all kinds of things were happening to him. At this particular time, this is the last letter Paul ever wrote, is wrote 2 Timothy. He writes to a young man named Timothy, a man that he had discipled, a man that he had mentored for many years. He's writing from the prison cell in Rome. It would be the last letter he would write because shortly after that he would be executed for his faith in Christ. Timothy was facing severe problems in the ministry in Ephesus, harassed by heretics, apostates, and persecution of the Christians in that area. Just like all Christians who face an endless battle, amount of opposition to follow Jesus, Timothy needed to be reminded to suffer hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Look at verse 1 of chapter 2. You then, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. Preparation, strength building, all this is part of what it means to be a soldier. If you go out and join the armed forces or have been joined the armed forces, you know that it is hard work. You know that when you get there, you're going to have to suffer hardship. A couple of weeks back, Adrian and I were down on the beaches of Grand Haven, And there was a group of Marine young men that just signed up. They were on the beach. They had these big, heavy logs. They had to pick up the logs, put them on the shoulder, and run down the beach for about 100 yards, turn around, and run back with a log on their shoulder. Then they'd get back there, and they'd have to run out to the end of the lighthouse and run all the way back with these logs. That's hard work. And when they got back, you could see their faces just red, totally unprepared for what they're about to face. Be strong. Get spiritually prepared for the battle ahead of you. Build up your spiritual muscles so you're able to fight the battle that is before us. As Paul writes this, he was chained probably to a Roman soldier. He was looking around at the soldiers that were in that prison guarding him. He saw their conditioning was perfect. They were in shape. Roman soldiers had to walk everywhere they went. They didn't have any other form of transportation. If they suddenly were called to go from Rome and march to France and Gaul, what they had conquered, it'd be 627 miles over the Andes, over the Alps and mountains and rough territory, and they would be able to march it, and they had to be able to do it. So Paul knew what he was talking about when he says be strong, because we need to be spiritually strong for the battle that's ahead of us. If we are not prepared for this battle, we are not going to be able to handle what's coming in the days ahead for the Church of Jesus Christ. How strong are you in your relationship with Christ? How do you have enough strength to do the battle against the enemy? He says here in this verse, you then, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. We came into the Christian life by grace. We are saved by grace, not by works, not by something we did, but what Christ did for us on the cross. And we live the Christian life by grace. Be strong in the grace. Learn to live in the power and control of God Himself. Learn to live under the power and control of the Holy Spirit. Give yourself over to Him so that the strength that you have does not come from your own ability to try to muster up a Christian life, but it comes from your ability to rest on Him and allow Him to fill you with His Spirit. Allow Him to take control of your life and the affairs of your life every single day, that you may be able to battle against the enemy that's out there. We walk by grace. We need to let God control our life. If you just back up in that chapter 1 of Timothy to verse 5, he lists six things he asks Timothy to do as he prepares to take on this ministry and to be strong in the graces in Christ Jesus. Verse 5, be true to the faith you've been taught. Verse 6, exercise the gift that God has given you. Verse 7, don't live in fear, but be bold in your faith. Verse 8, don't be ashamed to share your faith. In the latter part of verse 8, join in the suffering of the gospel, the battle of truth. In verses 13 and 14, follow my teaching and sound doctrine, guard it with the help of the Holy Spirit. Timothy recognized these 6 points and said as something he needed to do, and Paul was exhorting him to do. All these things are done in the grace of God, by Him and for His glory. We are only instruments of His grace in a godless world. So if you claim Christ as your Savior, you are a soldier. Just say that. I am a soldier. Oh, I'm sure I can say a lot better. Stand up. I am a soldier. Very good. Got it out. Well, there are 4 things he tells us what a soldier needs to do. A good soldier is willing to suffer hardship. He says in verse 3, and I'm going to go a little out of order here, but because I think it's just the way my mind thinks sometimes, out of order. But endure hardship with us like a good soldier in Christ Jesus. Endure hardship as a good soldier in Christ Jesus. Hardship is suffering evil or pain. To endure persecution, all soldiers need to learn to rough it. They need to learn to get involved in the, as par for the course for them to rough it. Christian soldiers need to be prepared for persecution as well. I think the North American church has become very soft. And we are used to getting pampered and provided for. We are accustomed to have a table of goods set before us and to consume whatever is before us. And then we choose which one we want. Most of us like to take it in what we get and not get involved any further. We hire others to do what we should be doing as part of the army of God. By and large, we've become lazy and apathetic in North America. But if we're going to survive the onslaught of the enemy that is yet to come, we have to get off our lazy boys and get down to work of ministry. There's no waste of time. The enemy grows stronger every day. If we snooze, we lose. Therefore, endure hardship. Matt Stafford is the quarterback for the Detroit Lions. And he's pretty good. Not as good as we'd like him to be, but he's pretty good. Now, if someone would come up to, if Matt decided, went to his coach and said, "Coach, I don't like those guys hitting me. I don't like those guys chasing me. I don't like those guys coming across the line and putting their hands in front of my face so I can't see where I'm throwing the ball. I don't like those guys tackling me. Coach, could you go to the other coach and say, lay off?" I'm sure his coach would come back to him and say, "Matt, we don't pay you $5 million a year to slack off. We pay you $5 million a year to have people chase you all over the field. We pay you $5 million a year to have people tackle you. We pay you $5 million a year to throw the ball even though their hands are in your face. Matt, tough it up." Secure, involved, endure hardship. Paul goes on to note with us. He is in the battle as well, and he said, along with other believers, we are in that battle, and we need to do it as well. Battle is ours together. God's looking for good soldiers to join up as a church to face the evil one. We don't do it on ourselves. We don't do it by ourselves, not individually. We are collectively a body of Christ. And here in First Baptist, we need to do the job that God has given us to do to advance the gospel of Christ. Are we going to be one of those that he can count on, willing to volunteer? We need to get involved as volunteers. As you see in the front of your bulletin, that we're not able to have our VBS this year because we didn't get enough volunteers, about 20 short. And so we have to recognize that some programs in the church need to go on. We need to get involved. I'm sure there are people here who have the ministry that could reach out to children, and you could get involved. I want to thank those who did respond. But we need to get enough to run an effective program. We need to, so we canceled it for this year. We need more soldiers to step up to the task of reaching children for Christ. Many of you have the ability to do children's ministry. Many of you could step up and do children's ministry. We have someone from Child Evangelism Fellowship here with us this morning. And she's going to share with us in a couple of Sundays to come a little bit about CVS and what's happening here in Eaton County. And so if you are interested in getting involved in our community right here in Charlotte in the children's ministry of five-day Bible clubs, let me know and I'll let her know. Or when she comes up, you can let her know. When she comes to share. So the first thing we learn is that we need to endure hardship. Second thing we learn from this passage, a good soldier is separated from civilian life. Separates himself from the life of a civilian. No one serving as a soldier gets involved in civilian affairs. Being a soldier is a 24/7, 365 job. It's not a Sunday-only job. When one becomes a soldier in the U.S. armed forces. Everything he has belongs to the branch of service that they choose. When you get involved in boot camp, they'll walk up to you and say, "You are no longer mama's boy. You're my boy." And that's what happened. You commit yourself to the Army. You commit yourself to the Navy. You commit yourself to the Marines, to the Air Force, to the Coast Guard, right? Thank you. Being a Canadian and American, I can't remember all. See, I've only been American since 2006, so you'll apologize if I don't remember all the forces. I can tell you all the Canadian ones, though. Even when on leave, they're subject to call anytime. They have to come back and serve. It's no different than the Lord's Army. We've been bought with a price. Purchased off the slave block of sin to be part of Christ's armies. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19 to 20, he says, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you received from God? You are not your own. You've been bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your body." That is why God tells us we are not to get entangled in the civilian life around us, not to get entangled in everyday life. You know, many Christians are entangled in everyday life. They live a dichotomic life. On Monday to Saturday, they live in the world. And on Sunday, they come to church and they say, "I live for the Lord." And we cannot live that kind of life if we're going to fight a battle. We have to live 24/7 for the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no time to waste. Not to get entangled with everyday life. You ever ask yourself how we get so tangled up, entangled all the stuff we're doing? You know, hours of the day and how much stuff is involved and just running the kids there or doing this and that and all the things that we do. How much time does God have in your life? How much time ought He to have in your life? He bought you with a price. You are not your own. You're His. And we need to listen to the Word of God as He speaks to us through that passage and say, "What am I doing with my life, Lord? Am I honoring you as a soldier of Jesus Christ? Am I getting out and getting involved in the things of God?" There's no place for the 80-20 rule in the church. God wants 100% of us fully committed to Him. Part of our time, all of us, need to be involved in an active service of Him. And go up, call goes out for soldiers. We should be ready to serve. There are lots of ways to get entangled in the affairs of the world. I won't get into all those ways. I think we find them in the Bible very clearly listed. In fact, you probably can figure it out yourself. But there's only one way to get untangled. That is full commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. Fully committing your life to Jesus Christ will untangle you from the affairs of the world and allow you to serve Him when He calls. The task, the Lordship of Christ, acknowledging His ownership over you in your time, over your time and your talents. Third thing I want to point out, verse 2. And a good soldier finds strength in the team. We're not in this alone. We don't fight the Christian battle alone. All the things we have heard, all the things you have heard from me, Paul says, entrust them to reliable men who will be able to be qualified to teach others also. Teaching the Christian army is a training process, a team effort. We are waiting for our new pastor to come. And when a pastor comes to our church, can't expect Him to do everything for you. In Ephesians chapter 4, it outlines the two separate things that need to happen. The role of the pastor, the role of the staff, is to equip the saints for the work of ministry. The role of the people is to do the work of ministry. The pastor is not called to do the work of ministry, but to equip you to do the work of ministry. And we, as a church, together, must do the work of ministry. Can't expect to do what God has called our pastor to do what God has called you to do, and I to do. It says, goes on, so the things we've heard, as we take in truth, as we listen and read and get involved in our small groups, whatever it is we're taking in truth, we need to take it in, and then that truth, consistently absorbing truth into our lives. Storing that truth in our mind and embedding it in our hearts. You know, the farthest distance sometimes from us is from our head to our heart. And we need to take the truth into our hearts and allow that truth to take home in our hearts. Verify that you know what is truth. And of course, Paul says, by many witnesses, he tells Timothy to verify truth. We have the Word of God. And we verify what is truth. Then he says, after you know the truth, entrust it. Give it up. Give it away. Give it to somebody else. Let them get a hold of truth. Don't keep it for yourself. Share what you know with others who need to know it. And he goes on and says, to reliable men who will be qualified to teach others also. In the church, we have to have an ongoing discipleship program that people are built up in Christ, go out and share what they have, and others will come to Christ, get to be discipled, go on and share what they have, and ongoing in the church. You know, we're not doing that. I don't believe there's a lot of churches that are really doing that nowadays. But that's what God calls us to do. Ongoing development, the people of God, that they may be a strong army for the person of Christ. Look to people you can pass on truth to who can pass it on also. We tend to take in a lot of truth in church. Sometimes we don't absorb that. But God calls us to action. Transfer that truth to others. And the fourth thing, good soldiers are submissive to their commanding officer. Good soldiers are submissive to their commanding officer. Verse 4b. After he told us not to get entangled in the affairs of this world, he wants us to please the one who enlisted him. Christ enlisted you and I. He is the one who enlisted us. He paid for us by dying for us. Today we honor in Memorial Day those who passed on to die, been out in the field, and die for the service of their country. We should never forget that sacrifice they gave. But never forget the sacrifice that Christ gave for you. He died for you also, that you might become a soldier of Jesus Christ. Now, he rose from the grave and sits at the right hand of the Father right now. And he commissions us to go out and do the work of ministry. Carry on the mandate to win the world for Christ. You know, there's a problem in Iraq today. The Iraqi army, whenever their problem comes up, they just drive away. As a Christian, when things start to get rough, are you going to just get in your Jeep and drive away? Or are you going to face the enemy, strong in Christ? Learn to be submissive to your commanding officer. We're called to please him. What pleases the Lord Jesus Christ? Loyalty pleases the Lord Jesus Christ. When we're committed to him, we allow him to remain true to all of him for all of our time. When we're obedient to what he says us to do, when he commands, we go. We don't say, well, I don't really know if I want to get involved. We need to get involved. Obedience and commitment and service, getting involved in the battle. Sticking to the task of the church. Not getting entangled in the world. We have to take a stand for Christ. In our day and age, there are many people who do not take a stand for Christ but claim to him as their Savior. We, as God's people, must take a stand for Christ. 100% committed to please him. Isaac Watts wrote a hymn, Am I a soldier of the cross? Am I a soldier of the cross, a follower of the Lamb? And shall I fear to speak his cause, own his cause, or blush to speak his name? Must I be carried through the skies on flowery beds of ease, while others fought to win the prize and sailed through bloody seas? He goes on to say in that song, Lord, I must fight if I would win. Increase my courage, Lord. And that's what we need to do as a church today. Increase our courage and say, I am a soldier. Whether you like it or not, you are a true believer in Christ. You are a soldier of Christ. How are you conducting yourself, soldier? How are you handling, soldier? Are you ready to commit to him? To be his soldier? In the days, the years that God may give us, we have a mandate to obey our commanding officer. Father, we pray that we would truly understand what it is to be a soldier of Christ. To endure hardship for the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Allow us to have that strength to endure hardship in Christ Jesus. Amen. And we have the joy this morning to commission two young people who are going to be going out this summer to serve. And Kim and Jason. And I understand they're going to get married again in September. Not again, but get married in September. So, okay. Anyway, one of them's going to go to a remote part of the world, to a culture that is primitive, has a lot of different innuendos to it, a lot of different things happening. And the other is going to go to Botswana, Africa. Yeah. So Kim is going to Canada, Edmonton, Alberta. I pastor a church about 15 miles away from where Kim's going to be serving. So good area, wonderful. Kind of call it remote, but the city of Edmonton has 600,000 people, so it's not really small. And a lot of people to reach for Christ. Botswana? That's the area of Africa that has all the animals you see, the elephants, all the wild animals, but they sure have a lot of modern buildings as well, don't they? They have universities, and that's where Jason's going to be serving, the universities out there in Botswana. I believe that's what that's being tasked, right? The universities out in the city? Right. I want to read this to you from Romans chapter 10. How can they call on one they have not believed in? How can they believe in the one whom they have not heard? How can they hear without someone telling them? And how can someone tell them unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. The Bible declares that God has commissioned every Christian to make disciples of all nations. We present Kim Rickard, Jason Weaver before you, as those who have responded to his call and are dedicating themselves now to help fulfill the commission that God has given us. Do you, Kim, commit yourself to do the work of the ministry in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada for this summer and to serve the Lord in response to God's call on your life?
I do.
Do you, Jason, commit yourself to do the work of ministry in Botswana, Africa for this summer to serve the Lord in response to God's call on your life?
I do.
We as a congregation of First Baptist Church are committed to God's mission to our community and throughout the world. And pledge ourselves, we need to pledge ourselves in the duty to pray for Kim and Jason as they go out in their individual missions to Canada and Botswana. I want you to stand with me for just a moment. Repeat this after me, please, as God gives you the will to do so. Will you join? We will join
in
supporting you
as you obey the commission of God.
Kim and Jason,
will and commands as we embark on these mission journeys.
Thank you. I'm going to ask some of the leaders of the church to come forward at this time and just to gather around them as we pray for them today. Board members? Yeah, you're the leaders. Good. Then will you pray first and foremost?
Lord, just thank you, dear Heavenly Father. Thank you for the commitment of the chance that you could have following your will. In our hands, we know the Father's good while. And then minister, dear Heavenly Father. We ask your guidance, your protection, that you're willing to help us. Your precious name, Heavenly Father, is great.
Father, we just commit these two to you and that each one of us, as leaders in this church, we just pray that you would anoint them for ministry. Bless Kim as she goes to work with children in the Sherwood Park area. We know, Lord, there are many people that need Christ in that area. So, Father, bless her, we pray. Use her mightily. Just daily supply her every need. Be with her, we pray. Pray for Jason as he travels to Botswana again, to serve there with the universities, with the people, to do street evangelism and campus evangelism. We pray, Father, you just bless him as he goes out. That you just make them soldiers of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. And bless them in their relationship, too, as they are parted from one another, as they come together to get married in September, we pray. In Jesus' precious name, amen. May the grace, peace, and wisdom of the Lord Jesus Christ go with you as you serve Him this summer.
Use us, O God, for your service.
Amen.